basically we have something like this. In a computer, we have this called, let me take this one. You have your CPU unit. This is your CPU unit, central processing unit. In this central processing unit, this is one chip, let us say this is a chip. And there is another chip, memory chip. This is another memory chip. And these memory chips, let us say we are calling them, these chips, RAM, let us say they are random access memory. So what happens is, this externally, I mean, if you come out of this box here, this box, external there is another magnetic disk, hard disk, okay, hard disk drive, HDD. So this also will interface, this will interface with this, your CPU unit. This is sort of bidirectional RAM, because we can write, data can go into and it can come out. So when you did not power on, this is, let us say this is power off. This is power off. When this is in a power off state, your programs, what all you have installed, all programs will reside in this hard disk, that is magnetic disk, hard disk. Your programs and data will reside in this. The moment when you power on and you want to access some, let us say there is a program called Microsoft Word or Office. So this you are trying to access. This program is loaded here from this portion, from this to RAM. Here it is loaded. So that is locally available now. CPU can frequently visit here to the RAM unit and can access this Word program that is loaded into the RAM. So when that is, when you power on your CPU, when you power on your CPU, you can access this way. But the moment when you power off, the moment you power off, this is this data you are going to lose. Your entire program, that this Word program and data relevant to whatever that file you have written, everything that is stored in this hard disk somewhere, some memory location, it is stored here. So meaning basically, when you power on, for immediate access, CPU is actually accessing your RAM. This memory, not this memory. This is auxiliary memory. This is your auxiliary memory. And this is your primary memory. This is your primary memory. Somebody unmuted, kindly mute. Check, everyone check. So this is your primary memory. So CPU when powered on, from the primary memory it accesses. So because of that, the intention of doing so, from accessing from here, is speed. We want to enhance the speed. If it is trying to access from this external, then it is a time consuming process. So we actually, the very intention of having a CPU is to minimize the time for any activity, computational activity or automated activity. We want to minimize the time. So, but that is not happening if we access externally from the auxiliary memory. We access from the primary memory, then we are able to minimize the time to access. So that's the one point that we have to understand between the auxiliary memory and the primary memory. So there are scenarios in this RAM. If you see this, let me take another slide here. You see this memory, your RAM, random access memory. This has got some address locations. Let us say this address location is 0, and this is 1, this is 2. Likewise, we have some address locations. N, this is N. So likewise, we have some address locations. we can go to any address location and we can access the corresponding word here residing inside this. Inside here, there is a word that is residing here that we can access. For access means we can read. We can read. So we also can write if need be. So write and read operations are performed. So what is happening here in this read operation or write operation? We have to have this address access. Through address, we are going to access the word that is there, the word that is there inside the memory. How is that we are accessing the word that is there inside the memory? Through this address. We should not be forgetting this address. Through this address we are accessing. Now the point is there a way to eliminate this address? Eliminate accessing anything through the address. Directly we have to access. Directly means, suppose say if I'm checking for hello. So I must access directly hello. What I put is, my argument is hello. If that is there inside the this memory, then I should be able to read out hello. If inside is not there, depending upon the command that I give to write or read, I should be able to write this hello inside the memory wherever that is available, space available. So meaning what? It's a content. Remember this terminology. Content addressable memory. So content addressable memory. So that is CAM. In external exam, write about CAM. It is coming. Those guys who are not familiar with this CAM, that full form, content addressable memory, without awareness, they may leave this question, which comes possibly for 5 months or sometimes 6 months. Write about content addressable memory. So, in short, they may give write about CAM. So, meaning content addressable memory. So, that you have to remember. So, the basic idea here today's discussion is, instead of accessing the word, instead of reading the word from the memory using its address, we have to access it, we have to read it, or we have to write it using content itself. For example, if you open your possibly this will give some insight to you. If you open your smartphone and you have stored somewhere, let us say, my friend COA, that name, with that you have stored. Another, you have stored my friend EMPL. Likewise, you have stored one contact like that, the other contact like this. So you forgot actually what was that you stored here, my friend name you forgot, suppose. But you remember that you associated with that COA or something EMPL. If you type in your search here, contact search, simply COA, now the list will pop up here, complete list with the COA, what all the contact numbers that you have stored, 1, 2, 3, like that, all list will pop up. Meaning what? You are not searching using the address. You don't know really the address where you have stored. With the help of content itself, you are searching where the contents are from in the memory. So that is the content. This content. So it's a contained addressable memory. Is that here? That's the point. That is what we are trying to see now in today's topic. It's a content addressable memory sort of discussion. This one here, this is associative memory. You see, this topic we are going to touch. Coming to this presentation here, this one, around 20 slides are there, no issue. We can cover up. If you have any queries, you can stop me and you can ask. So let us start with this associative memory topic. Let me change this. Okay. Now, main data processing applications require the search of items in a table stored in memory. Data processing, your FIR filters, you have something called there is a FIR filter, finite impulse response filter. I don't know whether you come across or not, but not to get into this, only point that I'm trying to make here is the data processing application, you know, data processing application. So the, in this data processing, there is a, this is a wherein you possibly, suppose say you have a multiplier, you have multiplication. You are multiplying A and B, A into B. So it's a data problem. Let us say this Y equal to AI BI. So AI BI means AI is a vector. B is also a vector. A is a vector, B is a vector. So we don't know the vector size. It may be 100. Vector size may be 100, A. And B also may be 100. So A of 0 into B of 0. A of 1 into B of 1. You are processing data actually. So frequently, you are processing data. So at that time, what is required is, such as, in that case, items in a table stored in memory. They are stored in some memory. All this vector data is stored in the memory. An assembler program searches the symbol address table in order to extract the symbol's binary equivalent. This is another example. This is one example. Main data processing applications require the search. They require the search. This is search of items in a table stored in memory. So data processing applications require search. What search they need? They need A of 0, B of 0, where it is. A of 1, B of 1, where it is. Like that, the search is required. This is main data processing application. Next example is an assembler program. This is another second example. Searches symbols. Symbol. Searches a symbol address table in order to extract the symbols binary equivalent. Suppose say you are typing in your computer something like that you are typing. So you are typing all this where using your keyboard. But what is really happening, this A has got some binary equivalent for that inside the computer to be stored. Similarly, P also has got some binary equivalent. So all such binary equivalents are stored in the memory. So what it does, this assembler program searches the symbol address table. There is a symbol address table. In order to extract symbols, the symbols binary equivalent. You are right. This is a symbol for that, this assembler program. This is a symbol. So the binary equivalent of this symbol is this one. So what it is doing, this assembler program, it is searching for the symbols. Again, what is the point here emphasized here is, searching. That is, the search is here that we are emphasizing. Through this example, search we are emphasizing. An account number may be searched. Again, we are emphasizing search. One place, second place, and the third place. We are giving examples. Here data processing application, here assembler program, here account number. So this is again a search in a file, to determine the holder's name and account status. So the established way to search, this search again, search fourth time we are talking about, is to store all items where they can be addressed in sequence. So this is important, addressed in sequence. Whose job? The established way. There is a established way, there is a standard procedure. Established way means there is a standard procedure. What for a standard procedure? To search. To search the stored items. How can we address it in sequence? They can be in a in a sequence manner, one after another. So the search procedure is a strategy for choosing sequence of addresses, reading the content of memory at each address, and comparing the information read with the item being searched until a match occurs. So this is again very clear. What is search procedure involved? In a sequence, it goes, it reads the content of the memory at each address, compare the information read with the item being searched. How long? Until match occurs. So the number of access to memory depends on the location of the item and the efficiency of the search algorithm. Two points here. One is the search algorithm. Efficiency, it should be efficient search algorithm. If you type in Google search algorithms, you will find innumerable search algorithms. Among them, there are efficient, meaning within no time, they help us to pick the item from the memory. So those are the search algorithms, efficiency we are talking about. And access to memory depends on the location, where it is located, meaning in your memory, suppose a huge memory. So it is lying somewhere here, that is 3014 address location. But sequentially, when you are searching 0 through all these numbers, so it is wasting actually all this time, right? So this much of time wasted actually. The moment when it has come here 3014, then it is finding the item. So meaning the location also matters. If it is coming early, then within no time we can access. If it is not coming early in the sequence, then we have to wait till that happens here. So that is again another issue that we have if you search that way. So the number of access to memory, this is already. Many search algorithms have been developed to minimize the number of accesses while searching for an item in random or sequential access memory. So this is again the same point. The time required to find an item stored in memory can be reduced considerably if the stored data can be identified for access by content of data itself rather than address. This is the point that is I was in earlier before starting this topic in the paint I was discussing. The time required to find, we can minimize. Instead going by rather than by an address, this the striken one here, rather than address, the content itself is used to search, then this time required drastically we can minimize. That's the point here. So a memory unit accessed by content called an associative memory. Remember, this associative memory. What is that? A memory unit accessed by content itself is called associative memory. The other name is content addressable memory. That is, the shortcut is CAM. So in external exams, be alert here. If it is coming as associative memory, then also the same answer. CAM, shortcut CAM, also is the same answer. The full form, content addressable memory, also the same one. So you shouldn't be having any confusion here. This type of memory is accessed simultaneously and in parallel on the basis of data content rather than specific address or location. So that this point in the paint I already introduced you before touching this associative memory topic. So when a word is written in an associative memory, no address is given. There is no address is given. The memory is capable of finding an empty, unused location to store the word. So earlier in the RAM case, what we used to do? A particular memory location we use it to have in the RAM case. In the RAM case, we use it to have addresses. So in this particular address location 3014, if I want to write, then I have to mention 3014 address location. Then I can read or I can write. So this is the read and this is the write. I can do with the help of address in case of RAM. But in case of this CAM, I don't need to mention the address. automatically what it does is empty unused location. It finds that. It finds that and stores the word there. When a word is to be read from the associative memory, the content of the word or part of the word is specified. So that is what I was telling again in the pain software. I said, you have stored contacts, something with the name and the COA. There are several names you stored, 1, 2, 3, 4, all the you associated with the COA, but you forgot particular name, one, two, particular name you forgot. If you put in your address, that is a contact search, COA, if you put simply, then all those contacts with whom you associated the COA will pop up here. So that is what the part of the word here. So that is what, when a word is to be read from the associative memory, the content of the word or a part of the word is specified. The memory locates all words which match the specified content and marks them for reading. That is what it does. So with this, let us proceed. Because of its organization, the associative memory is uniquely suited to do parallel searches by data association. Moreover, searches can be done on an entire word or a specific field within a word. That this already we have covered in the previous year. Yes, this we covered already. This one. So an associative memory is more expensive. This is the point to note. The more expensive than random access memory. The more expensive because each cell must have storage capability as well as logic circuit for matching contained with an external argument. So there is a trade-off. Here you can speed up the search operation, you are speeding up, but the other side you are increasing the amount here, but the other side you are increasing the amount. The reason for increasing the amount is logic circuit is required for such a fast search. Speed is required means some extra hardware is required, so that increases the price. And storage capability, this is again another, for that also price increases. For this reason, associative memories are used. So because price is more comparatively your RAM, so what is that where search time is critical must be very short. So search, you have to search. So where search is important, very critical means where search is important. And must be very short, in within no time you want to search. So in that applications, this associative memories are deployed, used instead of your random access memory. Instead of random access memory, these are used. Associative memories are used. For where important is your search is important, critical, very critical, and the time required is very short. In two cases, we can avoid this random access memory. We can go for associative memories. So every point here, the examination point of view important. Now we see the hardware, how this hardware is. So in this, basically what we have before discussing this theory, let us go to the state, see this hardware. The block diagram of associative memory is, you have argument here. The argument is, you are trying to search something. So suppose say you are trying to search hello world, is your argument. So that argument is in the argument register, that the word that you want to search is in argument. And the key is, For masking and unmasking. So we use for masking and unmasking. So we'll see that what it is. And then if you want to write something inside the memory, so here inside the memory, if you want something, that comes here, not in the argument register. You give this hello world, let us say this hello world itself, you want to write inside the memory. You give here as an input. You want to write here. So for that, you don't put here in the argument register. You give here in the input here. And if you want to read or if you want to write, if it is there, then you perform this. Associative memory, array, and logic. This inside is the logic. So what is there inside that we'll see? Let me hear this. So basically, it contains one is the argument register, the other is the key register, and there is a match register. So you have what you have here, m words, n bit per word. M words are there here, meaning 1, 2, 3, like that. How many are there? Total m. M words are there. N bits per word here. So meaning every word here, first word can store how many bits? N bits it can store. Can store n bits. Likewise, every word can store. Mth word also can store n bits. So for every word corresponding to every word, this match register has one bit here. If match occurs, then it stores one here. If no match, it stores zero. So meaning how many in a match register, what is the size here? Because m words are there. So m, the size, are you getting the point what I'm telling here? Let me again one more time. Here see, m words are there. One all through m. For every comparison that is happening, let us say first word is compared successfully. You gave something here. And that is matching with the first word. For this corresponding to the first word, here is a one flip flop that is set to one. If this somewhere some word is matching here, corresponding to that, there is a flip flop that is set to one. So meaning like that, how many flip flops will be there here? The size is a m, right? M is the size of the match register. Why? M is the size of the match register because corresponding to every word here, we have one flip-flop. How many words are there? M are there. So meaning M is the size of this match list. That is what the point that I'm trying to make. Okay. So now let us go to the bit theory here. This bit theory is the block diagram of an associative memory shown in figure 1 that we have seen. It consists of a memory array and logic for M words with N bits per word. That also we have seen. The argument register A and the key register K each have n bits for each bit word. That also we have seen here. This is n bits here. This is n bits and this is also n bits in size. Because we have here n bits. One word is of n bits. So throughout it's a n. But only this we have to remember, it's m. So that is what this point is. So the match register M has M bits, one for each word. That's what we have seen. Each word in memory is compared in parallel with the content of the argument register. Each word in the memory is compared in parallel with the content of the argument register. This how this comparison is happening, that we have to see. The words that match the bits of the argument register get a corresponding bit. The match register. So first word is matching means the corresponding bit of the match register. You know the match register you have seen like this. First word, this is the first word. If this match at the complete word is or part of the word is match according to our requirement here. This is the argument register and this is the key. If a key is a mask, suppose let us say I am keeping 111 here and this area is you perform suppose a 101. You perform, you use a AND operation. So this portion, let us discuss in detail later on, but here as a brief, I just presenting, this area I'm keeping all zeros here. This is the K register. This is the A register, argument register. And if I use the AND gate, and I'm setting this is one here, meaning this portion. For every bit, AND gate is required for every bit. This portion I am emphasizing here. meaning what, whatever comes here, this whatever comes here, this one, that will appear here on the output when this is one. Meaning when it is zero, that zero will be in here. When it is one, this one is in. This happens only when this is one. Is that clear? This happens only when the other input of the AND gate is one. So the other input, whatever the input here, that is seen on the output. So for that, in the K register, I am setting all these bits. Meaning this area can be matched perfectly, this area, using AND gate. So if my intention is to match part of the word here, meaning this match occurred for the first word, let us say this is the first word in the memory, and the corresponding to the first word in the match register, there is a bit that is set to one because match occurred. So that is what here, the words that match the bits of the argument register, set the corresponding bit in the match register. After the matching process, those bits in the match register that have been set indicate the fact that their corresponding bit, the corresponding words have been matched. That is very obvious. One is set means corresponding this one word is matched. So that is what the theory about that. And this one we have seen already. Let us go to further here. Reading is accomplished by sequential access to memory for those words whose corresponding bits in the match register have been set. Now, how is that reading happening? Reading is accomplished by a sequential access to memory for those words whose corresponding bits in the match register have been set. So, this match register has m bits now. So this is set to 1, this is last one, let us say, this is set to 1. The others are here 0, all are 0, let us say. So meaning this one and this one are read from the memory. So reading is accomplished by sequential access to memory. For those words whose corresponding bits in the match register have been set, this one, only these two are read. So that is what this one. The key register provides a mask for choosing a particular field or a key argument. So why the key register is used? Key register provides a mask for choosing a particular field. The argument register, we have several bits, right? N bits are there. In N bits, are we looking for complete N bits match? Then we have to set this key like all ones here. All ones. Why all ones? I told you people. This is a hardware after all. To use this is one bit is going to here. The other bit of the key is going here. This other bit all we are tying to one, let us say. Now whatever here is there, zero means this zero is in here. If one, this one is here. So meaning what is this bit, this matching is happening with the help of AND gate. So the entire argument is compared with each memory word if the key register contains all ones. You note that this one. The entire argument is argument is this one, argument register, the n bits, this entire n bits. The argument. The entire is compared only when if the key register contains all ones. Is that clear? If you have any doubts, you can ask at this point. How this comparison is done. One more time I will present. If you have any doubts, you ask. Suppose say your argument register has got one and your key register key has got zero. Now what happens? You are giving to the hardware. Your argument register one goes here, your key zero goes here. What is the output? Zero, no? There is no match, no? One is different, the zero is different. There is no match. I want to make match. So what I do, this zero, this is K. Instead of putting a zero, this K value, I put a K value as a one. Now, if here, earlier we took the one, no? Let one, you take one. So one is coming out, the match here, this one and this one. So zero coming, then also zero comes out, meaning the match is there. But this happened only when this, the other input is one. So that is what here, the key register contains all are one, then match up. Otherwise, no match. Any doubts here at this point? So I will count down our old formula, countdown formula. Start 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, or 0. So hope, no doubts. So let us proceed with further here. Otherwise, only those bits in the argument that have one in the corresponding position of the key register are compared. This is again very obvious. Wherever ones are there, that is the only that portion is compared. That is what the meaning. Thus, the key provides a mask or identifying piece of information which specifies how reference to memory is made. So, what basically key is doing? Key register. Key provides a mask or identifying a piece of information which specifies how the reference to memory is made. So that is what the key role is, key register role is. So, to illustrate with a numerical example, suppose that the argument register A and the key register if have the bit configuration shown below. This is our argument register. And the other is our key register. So this is our key register. Now if you see this portion, all ones here. Let me take this another. So this portion. All ones here. Here also all ones here. This is the argument. But I am talking about the key. This key, if you see, the portion here, let me take this one. This one. You see this one here? This is all ones here. These all ones, wherever there were the comparison is done. See, if you see this no match, we have written no match. Why? Because the word one is having here 100. So let me change this. This argument having 101. And your content addressable memory, inside the memory we have the word one. This entire one we have. But the match is happening only where the key register bits are one, and that is one here, only here. So at that portion, this matching is happening. So here, 100, no match. Are you getting the point? This is AND gate, let us say. This one you are giving here, and this key one you are giving here. So one. What is the output? One. Another AND gate. Next you give 0 here, this 0 here. Next 1 you give here. So this is 0, this is 1. So what is that coming out? Coming out is a 0. Next, what is that you give here? 1. So this 1 and this 1, T1. So this is 1. So 101 is the output. That 101 is matching with this only. So that's why this match occurs. But if you take this the other word here, this 10100, there is no match. This is not going to happen. This is not going to come. When you compare this to A and K, you perform this 101 is happening only with the word 2. That's why the match occurs. But word 1 is having 100, so no match occurred. No match. That's clear. So that is what this entire thing is with this example. So is this what we are trying to say? Where K is having 1111, there only match occurred. So let us go to this Word2. This is again the theory related. Word2 matches the unmasked argument field because the three leftmost bits of the argument and the word are equal. The relation between the memory array and the external registers in associative memory is shown in figure 2. Let us go to the figure 2. This is the figure associative memory inside what it is there. You see this, the second one here, second subscript. We have two subscripts here, P11, P1J. The second is J. So J is column. How many columns? N bits are there, means N columns are there. One indicates, the first one indicates which row, first word or second word or last word. That is row. So first word, second word, mth word. So that is what inside it. Now this is the argument register. This is your key register. So the match is like this. Whenever there is this area, this only our intention is to take these two. We have kept one here. So our intention is to match the contents of this entire argument to at this first two. So if match is happening here first two, then this is set to 1. If match is not happening here, then all are set to 0.